Thanks very much. Thank you for coming. Thank you for coming out tonight to, for those of you who don't know anything about Kasper Hauser, to hear about him. Is there anybody really for whom this is a completely blank slate? Please show. Great, and that helps me. Good. And for those of you who do know something, then I hope at least I can say something that can open up some new perspectives for you on this issue. Because it's a fascinating question. It's not only a kind of a first-rate thriller in the sense of a whodunit, but it's also a serious geopolitical issue. It's something which, although it happened 180 years ago, has, I feel, direct reference, relevance to what's going on right now today. And I'm going to start with today, and I'll finish up with today. It's also a deeply moving story, very human story, because, as Sean said, the other aspect of the story, the original title was Kasper Hauser, Identity and Evil and the Future of Europe. So this, the identity and the evil are also going to be in there, that will become very clear. Because this particular individual, when he finally died at the age of 21, he had suffered from various kinds of evil. And the question of evil today in our modern world is a really serious issue which is facing us with increasing intensity as each year goes by, I feel. And in a certain sense, what happened to him is a, we could say it's a certain, almost a template, if I could use that word, for how the forces of evil actually work. But it's not only Kasper Hauser as a victim. The question is what Kasper Hauser actually came to do in his life. What was his task, you could say, and how was that frustrated? What was this task that he came to do? And what's its relevance to Europe today? So that's where I'll start. And just a couple of quotes. One I particularly like from the novel by George Orwell, 1984. Those who control the past control the future. And those who control the present control the past. So in other words, if you're in a position to tell a nation what its history has been, where it has been, where it is now, and where it is going, then you are in a position to, as it were, guide the nation. And that could be in a positive sense or a negative sense. So certainly that's happening in my own country, in Britain, where our politicians tell us, well, this has been what our nation has been about since, for example, let's say the time of Henry VIII. And this, therefore, is how we need to go on into the future. And the use of history in the telling of the national story through the school system, for example, is a very important part of that. And then how that gets ramified out into the media, how these messages are communicated in various ways. Yeah. So that's the one point I just draw your attention to. And the story of Kasper Hauser, as we'll see, really relates to how, in this case, the Germans are being told a certain story about their past right now today. And Rudolf Steiner pointed out, the Austrian spiritual scientist, back in the beginning of the 20th century, he said that people always affirm only what is present and they do not pay due attention to what is absent. So in other words, we look at the people who are active in the cultural or political or whatever it is, scientific life, but we tend not to look at, well, what happens when somebody or some element is missing? Perhaps somebody or some element has been removed in some way. What then are the consequences when you have something which should have been and then is taken away? What results from that? These days, historians often like to talk about this in terms of what they call counterfactuals. In other words, imagining what-ifs. When I studied history at Manchester in the early 70s, historians were absolutely against that. Nobody did that. But today, this whole question of historical imagination is much more respectable in historical circles. Because when you start to imagine what if, then you realize that there are other alternatives. There were other alternatives in the life of either an individual or the life even of a nation. Other paths that a culture could have taken in its destiny. Yeah? And then you realize that if there are those other paths, you can see what mistakes an individual or a nation makes in its biography at certain particular crucial crossroads, you might say. And then how that nation or how that individual could understand that, if it can become aware of them, and then perhaps either return to that path, to that point in a sense, or at least realize how that option in a certain sense is still open to it and can take it up again and therefore heal itself. Heal himself, heal herself. So that's what Stein is pointing to here, is the importance of noticing what happens when, in the history of a nation, an individual, for example, or a phenomenon suddenly goes missing. And I'm sure we can all recognize that in history, in the histories of many countries, there have been key individuals who've clearly greatly affected the history of a nation. One can think of, say, in the history of my own country, William the Conqueror, or France, Joan of Arc, obviously Napoleon. Yeah? And I'm sure you'll be able to think of similar individuals in the history of Ireland. So certain individuals, by the roles they play, or by the fact that they were perhaps, as I said before, taken out prematurely, has a great effect on the subsequent history of that country. And this was certainly the case with Kasper Hauser. So I'm going to start by talking about the European situation now and then, in his time. Sean said, it's his 200th anniversary this year. He was born in 1812, he died in 1833. And then I'll speak about the attacks upon this individuality, which are still ongoing, both in Germany, which is where he first appeared in 1812, and also in the English-speaking world. And this is a very interesting thing. Why this individual is still being attacked in the English-speaking world so much later than his own life. Then I'll speak about a bit about the place where he suddenly appeared into the world and where he was on the world stage, where the world got to know him, namely the city of Nuremberg in Bavaria, and the meaning and significance of this place. And then I'll go through the story of Kasper itself. And then, as Sean said, then we'll take a break. And then I'll come in after the break to say something about the role of a very key individual in this story, an English aristocrat by the name of Philip Henry Stanhope, the 4th Earl of Stanhope. And when I got to know about this story of Kasper Hauser in the 1980s, through actually my interest in trying to understand the causes of the First World War, and trying to see what were the origins of the First World War, which I felt was somehow the crucible, you could say, of the 20th century into which I had been born, and I wanted to know what was this 20th century. So in seeking to try and understand these causes, I went back into the 19th century. That's when I came across the story of Kasper Hauser. And then I was fascinated to see that in this story, an Englishman played a key role. Well, the other day, I came across a Persian history book, and in this Persian history book, it said that under every leaf in the course of history, you will find an Englishman. Which is sort of part of this sort of Persian conspiracy theory of history, that the English are behind everything that happens in the world, you know. Well, you could excuse people in Ireland for thinking that as well. And there is a certain amount of truth in this, certainly in the last, say, several hundred years. So here in this story, you'll see that an Englishman again plays a crucial role, and it's not a very pleasant one. And then lastly, I'll speak about this question of the relationship between the German-speaking and the English-speaking world, and about Kasper Hauser and the future of Europe specifically. Okay, so to start with where we are now, tomorrow, 28th of June, does anybody know why the 28th of June is an important date in modern history? Barry?
Assassination of? Franz Ferdinand.
Right. Assassination of Franz Ferdinand, Archduke Franz Ferdinand of Austria-Hungary, which was actually the spark that started the First World War in 1914. Yeah? 28th of June happened in Sarajevo. There's another reason, 28th of June. Anybody know that? First World War started in 1914, First World War ended in 1918, but the peace treaty of Versailles, the controversial peace treaty of Versailles, was signed the following year in Versailles on the 28th of June. Okay, so the First World War began and in a certain sense ended with the 28th of June. Tomorrow, this gentleman, President of the European Commission, Manuel Barroso, and the President of the European Council, Rompuy, are going to present their latest thoughts on the future direction of Europe on this date. And basically they're going to tell us in this calendar or roadmap about their plans for more European integration, and this will lead to full economic union, Barroso said, on the 30th of May. They're looking to complete the process of economic and monetary union by having fiscal integration. That will mean centralized supranational control over the budgetary and taxational policies of independent nations. Point nations will cease to be effectively independent. Yeah? Because if a nation can't even control its own budget or its own taxation policies, then it certainly cannot claim to be independent in any sense. And of course that will mean that since we now have a flag, an anthem, a president, a foreign minister, a council, a government, a parliament, an army de facto, which is called NATO, most of the European countries are now fighting in Afghanistan, for example. They have their navies off the coast of East Africa. We already have, you see, in all but name, what you could call a European state. And this is going to be the last major building block in the process. So this is going to be announced by Barroso tomorrow. Now the media in the English-speaking world are trying to convince us that this drive towards creating a European superstate is coming from Germany, specifically Angela Merkel. So here we have, although this is the Irish Times, Angela Merkel was saying there, according to this newspaper, that Europe is in a race against time and the financial markets to solve the Eurozone crisis. It's an interesting way of putting it, yeah? That the European political leaders, is what she means, are in a race against the markets to solve the Eurozone crisis and actually to bring about greater fiscal integration. The lesson she suggested was not more money, but greater oversight by the ECB of national banking. The fiscal treaty is a first step to greater control at European level. So greater centralization. That's the Irish Times. And then the BBC, this is from the BBC website a few days ago. More Europe, Germany's battle cry. Notice the emotive language for the Eurozone. So the BBC, I've been watching them carefully for months now, trying to suggest to us that this is all a German plot to create a centralized European superstate. So it's the rallying cry, they say, of Germany's Angela Merkel. More Europe means we must give up more powers to Europe, she says. The lesson of this crisis is more Europe, not less Europe. And then the writer, Stephen Evans, asked this question. But is Berlin ceding power to Brussels also the route to a United States of Europe? So this phrase comes up, United States of Europe. The BBC has not used this phrase very often, but now it comes up very clearly. A picture of the German conception of Europe's future is emerging from the utterances of the German Foreign Minister Guido Westerwelle. Now there's a name to conjure with, German Foreign Secretary. Guido, guide. Westerwelle, literally Western Wave. So the German Foreign Secretary, ironically, and history often has the, you know, throws these kind of things up, yeah? Gives people names like the Guide of the Western Wave, or the Guide to the Western Wave. A man bearing this name is now in charge of Germany's foreign policy. And if you look into him, you'll find that Guido Westerwelle is very much a player in what you could call the transatlantic elite groups, elite circles within the German establishment. There are many such transatlantic think tanks in Germany, just as there are in Britain and I'm sure in Ireland as well. So they're saying basically that this plan for more Europe, more centralization, is coming from him and is coming from Merkel. It's the BBC. And then we have just one other example. Joschka Fischer, who was the German foreign minister recently, he brings another aspect to it. He says that he compares the politicians and the financial markets. And he says that a real political union will have to follow if Europe is to end this crisis for good. And then he asks, whom do we have to thank for all this European progress? Do we owe it to the wisdom of Europe's political leaders, particularly that of the Merkozy, odd couple of Merkel and French President Nicolas Sarkozy, who was? Unfortunately not, he says. Progress resulted almost exclusively from the pressure of the much maligned financial markets. It was the markets, not European leaders, that opened the door to European fiscal and political union. So in other words, he's flagging up that we've got pressure from two sides heading in this direction. One from the politicians, like Merkel and Vestergaard, and another from the markets. And who do we mean by the markets? We mean primarily the City of London and Wall Street. We mean George Soros, for example. Yeah? We mean Goldman Sachs. And so we see that, for example, various members of Goldman Sachs are now heading European government in Greece and Italy, for example. Yeah? But it's not only Goldman Sachs. It's the financial circles of Britain and America, the English-speaking world and America in particular. You've got this famous Irishman here, Peter Sutherland. He's a big player in this as well. Yeah? These people are all driving towards the centralized European solution. These circles, for example, here we see are allied to The Economist magazine, which is a magazine I always recommend people to read because it's one of the best examples, best media examples, which tells you what the Anglo-American elite are thinking about. So here we see, this is from May the 26th edition, very stark, Europe, breakup or superstate? Those are the alternatives presented. And then there's a question, is there a better way for Europe? Well, wouldn't you agree that that at least suggests to us that there's maybe a third possibility, right? You would agree with that, I think, yeah? But if that's the case, you might think that they might have put this text here in the middle. But no, we see that the text is placed under the superstate option. And when you read the editorial, which is 2 pages long, very unusual for The Economist, 2 full pages, so that suggests it's important. When you read the editorial, you see that the better way for Europe is not a third option for them. The better way for Europe is indeed the superstate. The superstate for them is the way out of the crisis. So they, like these financial circles with which, of course, they are intimately connected, are recommending that the only way out of our present malaise is closer fiscal and political union. Now, that option is something which was then discussed by Neil Ferguson, who is one of the leading historians in the English speaking world these days. Interestingly, he wrote a famous biography of the Rothschilds, so he's very into financial history, that's his speciality. Very big, over I think about 1,000 pages, big book on the Rothschilds. It made him £500,000, published in 1999. Then he went over to America, many doors opened, and now he's working at Harvard University. And he's been an advocate of Anglo-American imperialism for about the last 12 years, saying to the Americans, you should take on the English burden of empire and fully recognize that you should be the world empire. He's written a number of books on this theme. Anyway, in the Sunday Times of 20th of May, an article entitled, again, provocatively, One Nation Under Germany, one nation meaning Europe, he says, the text before his quote says, what of those who dreamt up the single currency wheeze in the first place? Shouldn't they now be feeling at the very least a trifle sheepish? Not at all, Ferguson reckons. If things play out the way he predicts, they will have achieved their ambition, albeit by somewhat devious means. Then quote from Ferguson, I think it's worth considering that the architects of the monetary union knew all along that it would lead to a crisis, and the crisis would lead to a federal solution. I'm not quite sure how far that was articulated, but I think it was implicit. In fact, you could say it was actually designed to create a crisis. Now, I don't believe him for a minute when he says, I'm not quite sure how far that was articulated, because this guy's a real insider. So he knows the score. And then he goes on to say, well, an example is given again by the writer of the article about an internal paper circulating in the Bank of England in the late 90s about a hypothetical breakup of the single currency around a hypothetical country, I, and the name of the country was not made explicit. This country would run an unsustainable deficit, and then because there was no legal exit, the cost of any exit would be sky high. Ferguson comments, designedly so. That point is held good. They, meaning the euro enthusiasts, have achieved what they wanted in that the level of financial integration has gone so far it's almost impossible to undo. And it was always meant to be undoable, which is why there was never an exit clause. You are never going to get federalism by any other means. So you see, Ferguson is really lifting up a corner of the carpet here. That he's pointing to the fact that this crisis is engineered. This whole financial crisis. And I think there are serious grounds for thinking this is really the big event we're looking at of 2012. The creation of the United States of Europe by the year 2013. And this fiscal integration, as I've suggested, is the last major step in the construction. The Economist title. The construction of the superstate. Let's go back, for example, to 1947. When Winston Churchill gave three great speeches in Britain on the question of united Europe. This is the second of them in 1947. In the Albert Hall, he said, "We do not, of course, pretend that united Europe provides the final and complete solution to the problems of international relationships. The creation of an authoritative, all-powerful world order is the ultimate aim towards which we must strive. Unless some effective world supergovernment can be set up and brought quickly into action, the prospects for peace and human progress are dark and doubtful. But let there be no mistake upon the main issue. Without a united Europe, there is no sure prospect of world government. It is the urgent and indispensable step towards the realization of that ideal. The urgent and indispensable step." So do you see, the people, and of course Churchill was himself very much an insider, the people who have been heading towards this European project for at least 60 years are not going to give up now. The media like to tell us that maybe we're about to see the end of the euro, maybe we're about to see the end of the European Union itself. But these people have been following this goal patiently, persistently, consistently for 60 years. And they have been basically in charge of European media, most of it, for most of that time. So it's not a question of them giving up at the moment. And we can go back even further. We can go back 100 years to the time of, for example, the British mining magnate Cecil Rhodes, who became wealthy through the golden diamonds of South Africa. And his ally, you may not have heard of this man, W.T. Stead, William Thomas Stead. He was a radical journalist, a very socially progressive thinker, but he was also an arch-imperialist and an occultist. He had his own connections with forces across the threshold and used to consult them, and they gave him advice. It's interesting to see what that advice was. These two collaborated with a British aristocrat called Lord Esher, Ronald Brett, very close to Edward VII. They created a secret society in 1891. Please don't take my word for any of this. You can check it out all for yourselves on the web. The goal was to bring about world domination by the English-speaking peoples, because according to Rhodes, only the English-speaking peoples deserved to run the world. Nobody else did. The English-speaking peoples were the new Romans, and they should run the world. And this would be done through the British Navy, and it would be done in such a way that Britain and America would reunite. So Rhodes considered 1776 to be a disaster, and that Britain and America should rejoin forces together. This has in effect de facto already happened, because the British, American, Australian, Canadian, New Zealand armed forces are already one unit. They operate together with the same harmonized material, the military hardware, with under the same surveillance and satellite umbrella, using sharing the same intelligence amongst them, not sharing that intelligence with their NATO partners who don't speak English. So in a certain sense, it's already happened, what Rhodes was dreaming about. One world power aiming at world domination. This is what these guys were planning. You've probably heard of the Rhodes Trust, the Rhodes Scholarship Trust. That was created by Rhodes to bring over young promising members of the American elite and fill their heads at Oxford University with English imperial ideas. That's still going on. Bill Clinton was an alumnus of that. The present leader of the opposition in Australia is also an alumnus of that. So this plan to create a United States of Europe, it goes back 100 years. In fact, Stead wrote a book called The United States of Europe, and another one called The Americanization of the World, the Trend of the 20th Century. They were eagerly looking forward to the takeover of world domination by the British people. Just give you one interesting quote here. In another book he wrote, The Pope and the New Era, bearing letters from the Vatican in 1889, Stead wrote, "What are the new characteristics of the new era?" He said, "There are three. One, the world is passing into the hands of the English-speaking peoples. Two, society is being reorganized on a socialist basis." Remember, this guy was a member of the elite. Although he was a progressive thinker, he knew all the people in the top of the British elite in the late Victorian period. And three, woman is at last beginning to be recognized as a being with a right to equal privileges and opportunities with man. Taken together, these three amount to the most sweeping revolution ever achieved on this planet, he said. But you get this interesting conundrum that although he was a socially progressive thinker, he was an arch imperialist at the same time. And in 1889, he wrote to Cecil Rhodes, even before they set up this secret society dedicated to English world domination, he said, "As it seems to me, your idea and mine is, in its essence, the undertaking, according to our lights," meaning according to our talents, "to rebuild the city of God and reconstitute in the 19th century some modern equivalent of the city of God, equipped with modern appliances, technology, of the medieval church of the 9th century on a foundation as broad as humanity." Now, isn't that interesting? He's saying to Rhodes that what we have in common, you and I, is a dream to recreate the Holy Roman Empire of the 9th century. 9th century is when the Holy Roman Empire was created by Charlemagne, who was crowned by the Pope in the year 800. Yeah? And here we have Stead imagining that this Anglo-American dream is to recreate this. So it's not only an economic and a political dream, it also a spiritual and cultural dream from on the part of these gentlemen. You can ask yourself, where is this coming from? Anyway, so it's not just something that begins this European project with Churchill. It goes back much further. It goes back to the time when the English and the American elites began to knit themselves together 120 years ago. And 3 years after Churchill gave that speech I read to you, we see 1950, the first step of the present European project starting, the European Coal and Steel Community, the goal of Jean Monnet, or the aim of Jean Monnet, the genial and very Machiavellian Frenchman. And then we see how in approximately 6 to 7 year periods thereafter, we have these phases where this European project takes a step further. 9 times 7 year periods next year will be 63 years. And as I said, I think we'll see then the final step in this project coming together. So The Economist, however, persists in blaming this on the Germans, so to speak. And you'll have, so you've got people on the left, on the soft wing of the conservative groups in Britain, like The Economist, blaming on the Germans. You have also people in the hard right of the conservative force in Britain, blaming it on the Germans, and they're basically saying, well, the European Union was started by the Nazis during World War II. It's a Nazi idea, a Nazi dream. You find a number of well-known books by right-wing Tories who follow this this idea. But as I'm suggesting, actually, it's much older than that, and its roots go back to English and American English-speaking circles of 100 years ago. Please can we start the engines now, Mrs. Merkel, says the economist. So in other words, the economist sees Germany as the engine of Europe. This is how the English-speaking world sees Central Europe, and specifically Germany these days, as an engine, as a motor. Nothing more is to be expected from Central Europe than just this cogwheel at the center of the economy. A place which makes good cars, you probably remember Vorsprung durch Technik, that's an advertising slogan, or produces good footballers for our entertainment. But anything of a cultural, philosophical, anything of a spiritual, anything of a new economic motivation or ideas of this nature, no. We are not to expect these from Central Europe anymore. We are to look only to the West, to the English-speaking world for these things. And yet, 2010, a member of the British elite, Peter Watson, he's been a writer for the Sunday Times, The Observer, and various American elite news organs, produced a huge great tome, this thick. I think it was about 600 odd pages, called The German Genius, Europe's Third Renaissance, the Second Scientific Revolution, and the 20th Century. What had been the contribution of Germany and Central Europe, the German-speaking world, since about 1750? And you only have to look at the kind of roll call of these various names, which appeared even only in the period from 1750 to 1850, from Leibniz, Bach, Herder, Goethe, Mozart, Schiller, Fichte, Erdinger, and Novalis. It goes on, yeah? Particularly in that period. Yeah? And of course, one can think of many others, Freud, Einstein, and so on and so forth, in the 20th century. So this book came out. I think actually such a book would not have been possible even 15 years ago. This was 2 years back. But already since then, we see this change. We see today, if everybody's noticed the cover of the new Statesman, I noticed it at the airport today, Angela Merkel with half her face taken away and replaced by Terminator face with the red eye and the machine face. Angela Merkel as Terminator, Germany as Terminators of the European and world economy. I kid you not, this is the New Statesman. It's supposed to be a left-leaning journal, supposed to be. But basically the same imagery as the BBC, as The Economist. Now on the back side of that issue of The Economist I just showed you now with the cogwheels, was this picture of Sean Connery in the Bahamas. Probably enjoying his retirement, yeah? But actually in advertising Louis Vuitton bags. So there he is, and of course, Sean Connery, what do we associate with Sean Connery? See? James Bond. He's made countless films since then, but we immediately think of James Bond because he was the first. Yeah? James Bond. He will always be seen worldwide in connection with James Bond. So why am I showing you this? Well, let me go forward a bit. I'm showing it you because I'll come back to those other things in a minute. Because in 1993, and this leads me to the question, why Kasper Hauser today? In 1993, this movie came out in Germany, Kasper Hauser, The Man, The Myth, The Crime. There have been two big movies about Kasper Hauser. One was in 1974, produced by the German art house director Werner Herzog. And most people in the English-speaking world who know of Kasper Hauser might have seen that film. Very touching film, very artistic film, but not really rooted in historical fact. This film is more rooted in historical fact, not 100%, there's some speculation, there's some imaginings, but much more rooted in historical facts and research than the Werner Herzog film of 74. And the film actually went on to win a number of German film awards the following year, 1994. Now, at the end of this film, Kasper Hauser turns over in his bed and dies after he's been fatally stabbed. And then the screen goes black. And then you see this text emerging in German, and here's the translation of it. And the text says, 1993, 160 years after Kasper's death, the House of Baden, I'll explain that in a minute, keeps its documents relating to Kasper Hauser locked away and maintains silence about the affair. Now, the House of Baden is the ruling house of what used to be the state of Baden, which is one of Germany's smaller states. Today it's part of Baden-Württemberg since World War II, down there in the southwestern corner of Germany where the Rhine goes like this with Switzerland, and you may have heard of Baden-Baden, and which is a sort of spa town, there on the banks of the Rhine. So this text was pointing a big fat finger, do you see, at the House of Baden. Keeps its documents locked away and maintains silence about the affair. So the filmgoers would think, well, so what does House of Baden know about this Kasper Hauser situation? Well, the nub of this thing is that Kasper Hauser is supposed to have been the prince, the rightful prince of the House of Baden, who was done out of his inheritance. And we'll see what the importance of that is in as we go along, yeah? So this is this fat finger that was being pointed. 2 years after this film wins the film awards in Germany, Europe's leading weekly magazine, Der Spiegel, brings out this November issue, 1996, Kasper Hauser, the disenchanted or unenchanted prince, the prince whose magic has been taken away from him. So here we see Kasper Hauser as he is in this picture, as he's supposed to have looked, although it's really only an imagination, when he first appeared, aged about 15 or 16, in Nuremberg in 1828. I'll come to that when I tell you the story. Here's the gravestone of Kasper Hauser behind. And here in his hand, instead of the letter which he was carrying when he appeared, is a floppy disk. And it says, gene researchers solve a centuries-old riddle. And that's because Stefan Aust, the editor of Der Spiegel magazine, called the German press corps to the garden, the very garden where Kasper Hauser was killed, or was attacked, fatally attacked, in 1833. And he called them there and announced to them that his magazine had organized a genetic DNA test on a stain, a blood stain, which they claimed had been found on the underpants, interestingly enough, the underpants of Kasper Hauser. And they had asked two specialists to investigate this blood stain, one from the University of Munich, a German, and the other, funnily enough, a Brit. A British government scientist working at the University of Birmingham. And that these two gentlemen had found that this blood stain showed that there was no genetic link between Kasper Hauser and any living descendants of the House of Baden, and that therefore Kasper Hauser had nothing to do with the House of Baden, and that therefore the whole story of Kasper Hauser was just basically a nonsense. A romantic fable from the age of romanticism, as they described it, which the German people basically should forget about. It's time to forget about this story, is how they presented it. But I'd like to draw your attention to this here down in the corner. Can you see this? This triangle, this yellow triangle. And it says, Agent Maus, in the case, the story of the German 007. Now, Agent Maus is apparently a German detective in a popular German TV series at the time. This is the 1990s, yeah? TV series. The story of the German 007. So here we have a reference to James Bond. We have a reference to a British secret agent. And then, as I've said, a Brit was also asked to investigate this DNA test. Well, science is one thing. Science can be rigorous. But of course, if science is not investigating the actual, real phenomena, then it doesn't matter how rigorous the scientific investigation, it's going to come up with a dud. So in other words, if those underpants did not really belong to Kasper Hauser, then it doesn't matter what the blood was on it. You know, it's not going to prove anything. And immediately people began asking questions. Whose blood is this? Where did these underpants come from? And so a battle started in various writings and magazines between those who were supporting Aust and Der Spiegel and those who were saying, no, we doubt very much what this is about. Because certain people pointed out, for example, this magazine, if you go back in its history, there are strong connections to the Anglo-American elite dating back to the period after World War II in the British occupation zone in northern Germany. Both editors, Augstein before Stefan Aust, both of these guys were key men in these same transatlanticist elite circles within Germany. So why is the Spiegel interested in rubbishing somebody who it clearly felt was a romantic fable anyway, a story of 180 years before? Why should they go to this extent of putting this on the cover? Because you see, since Kasper Hauser's death in 1833, thousands of articles, essays, magazine stories, books, and now web pages have been produced about Kasper Hauser. Films have been produced about Kasper Hauser. Researchers have given their lives trying to research material about Kasper Hauser. Yeah? The greatest of those was Hermann Peace, who published huge documentation in 1966. An incredible amount of work has been done on Kasper Hauser since, particularly since the beginning of the 20th century. People have been fighting over the truth about this individuality. Why? What's this about? Here's the garden where Aust invited the people, the garden where Kasper was fatally stabbed by the statue of a German poet. And then here's the memorial which is put up to him in the town of Ansbach, which is 25 miles from Nuremberg. And the statue says, here an unknown killed an unknown on the 14th December 1833. But this is no longer the case, because now we know who Kasper Hauser was. We also know who killed him. We know who organized the killing. We know who was behind it, both at the local level and who was behind it at the big macro geopolitical level. This information about the DNA test went online, of course, in the 1990s. And if you looked for Kasper Hauser on the web, you would find this story, that the DNA test of 96 showed that basically this is all a fraud. It has nothing to it. And then in 2001, Martin Kitchin, Professor Emeritus, Simon Fraser University, Canada, publishes this book, Kasper Hauser, Europe's Child, Macmillan Press. Europe's Child because Kasper Hauser, soon after he emerged in Nuremberg, was dubbed the Child of Europe by the mayor of Nuremberg. And it's under this name that his story then got out into the press, and that went all over the press everywhere in Europe, and even went as far as the USA. So people were interested in the story of this young man throughout the 5 years in which he was in front of the public before he was killed. So from his age 15, 16, until when he was killed at 21. Martin Kitchin, when you look at his bibliography, all the books that he's written, you see that he's an academic who specializes in military history. So he goes into the history of the German officer corps, the British officer corps, British foreign policy, British military history, British Commonwealth and imperial history. You see all these books, boom, 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 boom. And then in the middle, 2001, Kasper Hauser, Europe's Child. You think, strange. Why should he be writing about that? And then you read the book. And I have to say, if somebody is interested in all of this, it was not an easy book for me to read. because this was the most vicious, the most aggressive, the most mean-spirited attack on the individuality of Kasper Hauser that I, certainly that I've read in English, and I've read a number in English. But this is the worst yet. From an academic who, let's face it, academics are supposed to be balanced, but he certainly was not. And again, I had to ask myself, why this venom against this individuality? But you know, things have a way of working out ironically in history, because 6 months after he published that, in December 2001, in a castle on the Swiss-German border, not far from Basel, Schloss Boygen, a room was discovered, which had previously been unknown, in this room, in this building here, in this castle. And on the wall of that room was discovered a red horse drawing. This red horse drawing was carbon dated and found to be commensurate with the early 19th century. The building, and I visited this place twice, the building where the room is in, was constructed, for what it's worth, in 1666. I just mentioned that, but I mean, you know, it's a year, but mass grave of 3,000 prisoners of war, Austrian prisoners of war in the Napoleonic Wars, outside this castle here in the grounds. They died of typhus. Because of that, no locals went anywhere near this castle, which is where we know that for about a year, between a year and a half, Kasper Hauser was kept in this prison after he had been abducted as a baby. So he was abducted as a baby, and then he was kept in Karlsruhe, where he was born, for about 2 to 3 years. And then he was moved to this castle, where he spent a year and a half. And then he was moved to another castle. I'll come to that later. But this was discovered in 2001. And this led the Franco-German TV team, the TV station Arte, to organize a second DNA test, which they did. This was led by Professor Brinkmann of Münster University in Germany, and they looked at a lock of hair, which was absolutely known, no question, 100%, so that the Spiegel was unable to challenge this. It was known 100% to stem from Kasper Hauser. This was compared to the female line of the House of Baden, going back to Stephanie de Beauharnais, the supposed Kasper's mother. And the match, the genetic match, was found to be 95%, which apparently, I'm not an expert in this area, but this apparently is supposed to be as good as damn it in this field. Professor Brinkmann then concluded that there are no grounds for thinking that Kasper was absolutely not the Prince of Baden. So we were back again into this argument, you see. The scientific argument between was he or wasn't he on the basis of genetics. But if you only look at that, you can come to one conclusion. If you then look at the enormous body of evidence dating right back to the time of Kasper Hauser himself, the people who actually saw him, who actually recorded their impressions, their thoughts about him at that time, and take that into consideration as well, then you have another picture altogether. Anyway, since then, the Spiegel has not come back with a counter-argument. Yeah? That was 2002, then, when Arte produced a TV documentary about its findings, including the findings of the second DNA test. So the struggle for the truth of this individual is still going on today. And now here we are, 200 years on from his anniversary. Now, if you're a young person, for example, and you don't know anything about Kasper Hauser, and maybe you just hear something and you decide to find out something, many young people might go to Wikipedia, right? Just maybe, even if they don't believe everything Wikipedia says, and let's face it, who does? It can at least be a useful jumping off point to other places. If you go to the English version, the English page about Kasper Hauser, you see this. Theories propounded at the time linked Kasper Hauser with the princely house of Baden. These have long since been rejected by professional historians. It's the English page. Very categorical, yeah? Footnote. You look at the footnote. So who are these professional historians? Reinhard Heidenreuther. Who's he? Well, you look into him, and you find out that Reinhard Heidenreuther is no less than the Bavarian state archivist. So, of course, he's a historian. He's a professional. But this is the Bavarian state. Now, I haven't told you yet that the second prison in which Kasper Hauser was kept was in Bavaria, and it was owned by a major who was a direct subordinate of the king of Bavaria. And that furthermore, this major, his son, the godfather of his son, was the king of Bavaria. And that furthermore, after Kasper was put in this prison, the career of this major took off. So here we have the state archivist, basically is one of these people quoted as these professional historians who rubbishes the story of Kasper Hauser. Just to note that, yeah? That this picture is a very one-sided picture, even on the English pages. And I'll give you some more evidence of that. More evidence of the English pages of Kasper Hauser. In red, Philip, texts by Philip Henry Earl Stanhope. This is the secret agent I mentioned, who spent 2 years in Germany after the death of Kasper Hauser, slandering Kasper Hauser, paying for texts, articles, essays, books to be written about Kasper Hauser, saying that he was a fraud. Stanhope spent 2 years paying for that. Then we have Stanhope's daughter, also the Duchess of Cleveland, defending her father against Stanhope, the secret agent, against the people who criticised him. Then we have Andrew Lang, a Scottish writer of historical mysteries and other such sensational stories, also slagging off Kasper Hauser, saying it was a load of nonsense. Then we have Ivo Striedinger, two things by him. Who's he? Well, if you look into Ivo Striedinger, you find he was the Bavarian state archivist in the 1920s and 30s. And if you look into his texts, you find he's even more vicious and aggressive than Heidenreuther, who even seems to be quite a balanced chap compared to Ivo Striedinger. And then at the bottom here we have Martin Kitchen. So it's again a pretty, again, one-sided picture. And those are the English pages. On the German, this is the German page about Ivo Striedinger, just describing what he was and his position in the Bavarian state Hauptstaatsarchiv, yeah, since 1921. Professor at the University of Munich, critic of the Prince theory of the origins of Kasper Hauser, as he wrote in his 1933, 100 years after the death of Kasper Hauser. New writings about Kasper Hauser. Then if we look at the page, the German and English pages, about the man who's supposed to have been Kasper Hauser's father, his actual father, Prince or Grand Duke Karl of Baden, then the English says, it's been speculated that the foundling Kasper Hauser was his son, and therefore the actual hereditary prince, a claim now established as false. So again, this categorical assumption, yeah? In the English page, whereas the German page is not so categorical. Yeah? It simply says here that when it refers to the children of this prince, it says that one of his children was a nameless prince. He wasn't officially named before this baby suddenly disappeared. A nameless prince, born 1812, according to rumours, is supposed to have been exchanged on his deathbed, and then later is supposed to have appeared as Kasper Hauser. Nothing about the claim now established as false. So in other words, the English page is even more aggressive, you could say, than the German page. Interesting. If we go very briefly, look at other examples from the German pages, we see references, the two references to Striedinger at the top of the page, the two references to Heidenreuther at the bottom of the page. And then these other characters here are lesser academic figures, but they're all basically against the Kasper Hauser. Extremely one-sided picture you get from consulting Wikipedia, either in German or in English. We find that Heidenreiter, just to mention it, in 1979-80, he goes over to America, he's got connections in America, he did studies in the National Archives in Washington. That needn't mean necessarily anything specific, I just pointed out. Yeah? He's also a strong member of the Catholic educational and student circles in Bavaria. Again, that's not surprising, Bavaria is a Catholic state. But Nuremberg is a Protestant city, traditionally. Finally, again, references on the English page. We have Stanhope, we have his daughter, we have Andrew Lang again, we have Eva Schriedinger again. Then we have the one book which tells us something about Stanhope in English, history book. The Stanhope's Achievement, a Family Biography, 1969. It was written by a young historian. It was almost his first commission by the last Earl of Stanhope. It's a hagiography. It's a work of praise. It's not a balanced text at all. It says basically the Stanhopes were a jolly good family and did wonderful things for the British, for the British state and country, eh? During the years of their existence. So that's the only text referred to there, and of course it supports the story of Stanhope in the Kasper Hauser, Kasper Hauser story. But the most detailed and recent study of the life of Lord Stanhope yet published, which is by Johannes Meyer, Philip Henry Lord Stanhope, the opponent of Kasper Hauser, published 1998, is not even mentioned here. It's a great big thing, thick thing like this, 685 pages. It's not even mentioned. Yeah? Whereas Ivo Striedinger, who wrote in the 1920s and 30s, we see him all over the web when it comes to Kasper Hauser. Yeah? I know this book by Meyer because I've translated it myself, but I've now got to try and get that published in English. Probably won't be easy because it's so huge. Yeah? Meyer really did his homework on that text. And finally, footnotes to English Wikipedia page on Stanhope. We see again Striedinger. We see Stanhope again himself, his own text about Kasper Hauser, 1836. And we do see a reference to the Meyer book. But it's only one footnote. That's all it is. So it's kind of lost in this huge amount of anti-Kasper Hauser references. So that's what you get on the web. Yeah. In Striedinger's book, and this book by Schreitmuller, which is 1991, on Stanhope and Schreitmuller there is one, max two pages on Stanhope. Johannes Meyer, 653 pages on this English secret agent. Yeah. Not mentioned in any detail in any of these Wikipedia pages. Okay, so with Striedinger, I would argue that so much research has been done since he wrote in the 1930s that really renders his own work pretty much irrelevant. So, for example, he says there's no evidence that Lord Stanhope was a paid agent at Striedinger in the 1930s, but it has now been discovered. We even now have the checks that Stanhope actually wrote. The old question, follow the money. Right. So a paper trail has later been established, which is described in detail in Meyer's book, which led directly from Stanhope to Moritz von Haber, who was a banker and was the lover of the Grand Duchess of Baden, and she arranged for the murder of Kasper Hauser. There are various, so these are just a few other examples of how Striedinger's evidence, which he produced in the 1930s, has been superseded by subsequent research. One last thing, Striedinger writes, quote, "The Earls of Stanhope in the whole 18th and 19th century enjoyed the greatest respect. Is it likely that the pious heir of the third Earl would be such an adventurous and shady character?" The assumption that British aristocrats are jolly good chaps and all spiffing gentlemen. Yeah? Well, this is Ireland, I don't need to say much more about that. But we know, for example, that the third Earl of Stanhope was regarded by his fellow English aristocrats as a maverick eccentric, a sympathiser with revolutionaries. He supported the French Revolution. He was an object of scorn by most of high society in England. He provided his own son with really dubious characters as teachers, one of whom was very possibly a paedophile. And the Earl even kept his own son a prisoner in the house, so much so that his own son actually arranged his own escape from his father with the help of his half-sister and with the help of Britain's master spy, Francis James Jackson, and William Pitt the Younger, no less, with whom Stanhope was related by blood. So he's not just any aristocrat. This is an aristocrat at the top of British society, and yet his own father was regarded as a persona non grata, a complete eccentric by his fellow aristocrats. So Striedinger's statement here about enjoying the greatest respect is frankly does not correspond with the facts. So, the story. Kasper Hauser appears in Nuremberg, in Unschlittplatz. This is this place here. This is how it looks today. In the city of Nuremberg, which is over there in the southeastern part of Germany, in Bavaria. As I say, a Protestant city in a largely Catholic state. Unschlittplatz is an interesting name, because Unschlitt translates as tallow in English, animal fat. So it's the place where in the Middle Ages, for example, the animal slaughterers, the butchers, would slaughter, after having slaughtered the animals, they would then take the fat and sell it to the candle makers. So out of the slaughter of animals comes light. That's what happened in Unschlittplatz at this time, or rather in the Middle Ages, I should say. Hence the name, Unschlittplatz. Out of the death of the animals, out of the innocence, you could say, comes light for human beings. It was a Whit Monday, so the city was mostly on holiday. There were not many people about. But, you know, in those days, entertainment was people would sit and look out their windows and see what was going on down in the streets. Yeah? So that's what they were doing. Not much was happening. But then they saw this bizarre-looking guy dressed like a peasant. And he comes down the street. They go out. They ask him, can we help you? And he says in broad Bavarian accent, I can't do a Bavarian accent, so I'll do a Northern English one. So if he'd been speaking Northern English one, he would say something like, I want to be a rider like my father were. And that's what he kept repeating. Every time anybody said anything to him, he just repeated, I want to be a rider like my father were. I want to be a rider like my father was. And when they looked, well, these two guys, they didn't know what to do with him. They looked at the envelope which he had in his hand. It was addressed to a captain in the cavalry. So they took him to the captain's house. The captain came, read the letter. They kept asking Kasper questions, of course. He kept repeating his phrase. He didn't seem to be able to say anything else. He couldn't stand up properly. He had to lie down on the floor. They tried to give him drink and meat and things to eat. He couldn't take any of that except bread and water. He didn't want anything else. The captain didn't know what to do with him. He handed over him to the police. In the police station, he was even worse treated. So they kind of taunted him and again tried to force him to drink beer and eat meat and all kinds of other things, which again he refused, made him sick. They didn't know what to make of him. And again, as I say, he kept on repeating this same phrase. But then somebody had the idea of getting him to write. What's your name? What's your name? And he was given a pen. A pen was put in his hand. And amazingly, they found that this boy, who didn't seem to be able to do anything and seemed to have the mental age of about a three-year-old, could write his name in a passable script. Kasper Hauser. So, that's the circumstances which he turned up in Nuremberg. They didn't really, again, know what to do with him, so, we'd better just stick him in the city jail for a while until the city authorities decide what to do. So they put him in the city jail. Of course, jails were different in those days. This was the age of bedlam, when people used to go and make fun of people in mental hospitals, right? So all the locals came to gaze, because of course the story got round. There's this weird young man has appeared in town. So they all went and sort of made fun of him and humiliated him. Some of them gave him presents, they gave him gifts. There was mixed human reaction. Half sympathetic, half contemptuous, half entertainment. Well, a third entertainment. But what you might call a typical human reaction at the time. But this young man, or young, still child as he was really, he couldn't take this, as you could well imagine, yeah? And it almost seemed to drive him crazy at times. Then after a while, the mayor of the town decided to bring in a local judge to look at Kasper. The mayor, who had first of all given Kasper to put him, ordered him to be put in the prison and looked after by the local jailer, a man called Hiltel, I'll show you that in a minute. Then the mayor really responded wonderfully well to Kasper. There's something in Kasper's being which really spoke to him. The mayor felt something touched him about this boy. And that's why it was this mayor, his name is Binder, who then announces Kasper to the world as the child of Europe and says that the city of Nuremberg will look after him. And then he brings in this judge, Judge Feuerbach. And Judge Feuerbach says, well, we have to get him out of this horrible place, and we have to get somebody to look after him and to teach him and to bring him up and to help him. And so it's the judge who then suggests that a teacher, a Georg Friedrich Dalmer, should then look after Kasper and help him to fit into the world, so to speak. So that's how Kasper then comes out of nowhere and lands in the house of Professor Dalmer, who at this time is 28 years old, very interesting man, very interested in homeopathy, very well trained, very well educated, very sympathetic heart. And he then looks after Kasper. Kasper lives in his house until the end of 1829, beginning of 1830. So nearly 2 years. And Dalmer then educates Kasper and works with Kasper and helps Kasper to integrate himself to a certain extent in the modern world. And Kasper makes incredible steps very, very fast from somebody from the age of about 3 or 4. Everybody's astounded. And Dalmer, everything that Dalmer does with Kasper, he writes down almost in a scientific way and hands over to the press. And that's how the whole of Europe gets to know about Kasper, week by week, what the experiences of Dalmer with this boy are reported. Hence the title, The Child of Europe. I'm going to stop there for a minute and just say a couple of things about Nuremberg, this place where he appears. So here it is. Here's Bavaria, here's Baden, where Kasper was born, and here's Nuremberg. It's the city of the painter Dürer, Albrecht Dürer, the Renaissance painter. The first painter, really, we could say, who really started to paint personal portraits of the individual. But that's not all. This was Nuremberg's high point in the late Middle Ages. It was really blossoming as a city. It had always been on the crossroads of the trade routes of Europe. But in the 14th century, the Holy Roman Empire Emperor Charles IV, who the Austrian spiritual scientist Rudolf Steiner said was the last initiated emperor of the Holy Roman Empire, the last initiate to sit on the throne of the Holy Roman Empire, this man did something very special. He proclaimed something called the Golden Bull, which is a constitutional document. And this document laid down how the political form of Germany would be from then on. And according to this, what he did in this document was he basically ensured that Germany in the following centuries would not be a unitary state like countries of Western Europe, France, Spain, Britain, Portugal. Yeah? It would not be a state like that. It would be and also a state ruled by blood hereditary primogeniture, It would not be that. It would be an elected empire. And it would consist of many, many states. And the leading princes, seven of these princes, would elect the emperor. So, and they would have to somehow relate to each other in order to elect this emperor. And this was the inspiration, if you will, or initiation, or initiates thought of Charles IV. And he also decreed that the imperial regalia should be kept in Nuremberg, the crown jewels. And here we see some scenes of Nuremberg. Still today you can see a lot of this medieval scenery there, although it was badly destroyed in World War II. But if we go even further back, even before the Christian time, and look into this name Nuremberg, we say in English, but in German it's Nürnberg. Nuremberg. The three, which reminds us of the three Norns, or the three fates, as they were known in pre-Christian times in Germanic mythology from Scandinavia down into Central Europe. And these three fates were three women who held the threads of destiny in their hands, so to speak, and wove it. And these three women were known as Urðr, whose name means that which has come to pass, Verðandi, what is in the process of happening, and Skuld, or Schuld, debt or guilt, from which we get the English word shall or should. So it's what is due, what is owed in the future. And these three are sometimes associated with these three primal colours, white, red and black. The past, the present and the future. So these three were supposed to be, and their place where they were active was on one level supposed to be at the base of the world tree, Yggdrasil, in a Nordic mythology, yeah? The world tree. But on the earthly level, it was supposed to be here in this region, the region of Nuremberg. So that's an interesting thing to notice about Nuremberg. But of course, in the 20th century, Nuremberg becomes famous for something else. Nuremberg becomes famous for a kind of initiate of a different nature. Adolf Hitler, from where he spoke out his words of poison and hatred and violence right across Europe through the means of modern technology, from this city which the Nazis deliberately chose because they felt that this city represented the heart and soul of Germany. So it was from this place, and not, for example, from Berlin, the political capital, where they wanted to establish their occult, if you will, power over the heart and soul of Germany and speak out their words from this center, this ancient center, with the colossal events of the Nazi party rallies, which took place every year from 1934. One year, Kasper Hauser again, 1833, Hitler comes to power, 1933, and then the Nazi party rallies here, you see them taking place in Nuremberg, here's Hitler in Nuremberg in 1934. Grand Duke Karl of Baden here, it was a political marriage so that the French could have their say on the other side of the Rhine as well. Here, political marriage. So it was Napoleon, therefore, who actually brought together Kaspar Hauser's parents. And this relationship between Napoleon, who, let's remember, tried to unify Europe in a different way, 200 years ago, in the old-fashioned way, through war, the military way, the martial way, it was Napoleon then who paradoxically brings together the parents of Kaspar Hauser for his own political ends. Kaspar Hauser's mother then, to repeat, is the adopted daughter of Napoleon, which makes Kaspar Hauser the grandson of Napoleon, not by blood, but by, just by marriage, let's say. But when Napoleon heard of the birth of Kaspar Hauser, on St. Michael's Day, the 29th of September, 1812, Napoleon was over here in Moscow, because as you'll remember, in 1812, the West attacked the East. Just as today, NATO is pressing its radar and its rockets up against the borders of Russia. Just as today, NATO is looking for opportunities to interfere in Syria, in Iran. NATO, the West, pressing against the East. So 200 years ago, the West, in the form of Napoleon, was pressing against the East, ignoring the center in a certain sense, going over the center, pressing against the East. So that's how Germany looked at the time. What had been 360 states before the French Revolution was sort of reduced to not more than 30. Here again is Baden, Karlsruhe, and here's Bavaria. And then after Napoleon was overthrown, we had the Congress of Vienna, where the victorious allies, Britain among them, decided how Europe would then look. So here again, Baden, which did not actually change. It had grown quite a bit during Napoleon's time. But one interesting thing that happened, is that the next slide? No, it isn't. I'll show it to you later. These arrows show you the movements of Kasper Hauser after his birth. So he's born here in the palace at Karlsruhe, as Prince of Baden. And then 2 weeks later, it is announced that this healthy baby suddenly dies. And, well, that's just announced, and so very sad, but the prince has died, and that's that. What actually happened was that the baby was exchanged with the son of a servant of one of the wife of the Grand Duke. Or had been the Grand Duke, I should say. It was her goal to put her son on the throne instead of the baby Kasper. So she, I'll go into that a bit more in a minute, she exchanged these babies, and then after 2 years, I mean, first of all, the baby was put with the servant's family here in Karlsruhe, then the baby was moved down here to the castle I mentioned earlier, Boardman. And then the baby was moved over here, into Bavaria, just south of Nuremberg. And in this castle, the child now aged about 5, was kept there for about 10, 11 years. And then suddenly was released, as I said, on Whit Monday, 1828, in Nuremberg, and lived in Nuremberg for 5 years. And then, lived in Nuremberg until 1831, so what's that, 3 years. And then was moved by the Englishman, Lord Stanhope, to this town, Ansbach, removed from the circle of friends who were looking after him and taking care of him, put into Ansbach where he was isolated, and that's where he was eventually murdered in December 1833. So those are Kasper's movements. In that year, 1812, when he was born, just to, for what it's worth to mention, a great comet was appeared in the sky through 1811, 1812. Some people wondered at the time, perhaps superstitiously, if this had anything to do with Napoleon. But traditionally, many people have recognized, or it was a common belief, that when great individualities were born or when they died, this meant that when a comet was seen, it was said that a great individuality had passed or had arrived. So, Napoleon, 1812, the great figure who strode across Europe and was at that time invading Russia. He was sitting in Moscow when the news came to him of the baby Kasper's birth. You see this red, this martial red with which he surrounds himself. You cannot get a stronger antithesis between Napoleon, the man of Mars, the man of power, and Kasper Hauser, who for most of his life spent a great deal of his life in prison and then when he came out was a totally vulnerable young person. So there's Napoleon fighting his battles, waiting for the surrender of the Tsar in Moscow. And the Tsar he was fighting was Tsar Alexander. And Tsar Alexander was married to Kasper Hauser's aunt. Because you see, the family of Baden, they were quite clever. They married their girls off to many of the rulers of Europe. So even by blood, Kasper was in a certain sense could be described as the child of Europe, this Prince of Baden. He had one aunt in the Kingdom of Sweden, he had another in the Kingdom of Prussia, he had another in Russia married to the Tsar. In England, however, this was going on in 1812. Children were working underground, in the mines, in the factories, sometimes for 10, 12 hours a day, for profit, for industry, to drive the new English industrial revolution. It's interesting that this is happening, you see, that children were being treated in this way, in this inhumane way. And this, in a certain sense, is what also happens with Kasper. He is placed in this prison in near Nuremberg and is treated like those children. He's kept in the dark. While England's profits were being overseen, in a certain sense, you could say, the power of England was represented by Augustus Frederick, Duke of Sussex, Grand Master of British Freemasonry, which during the Empire, of course, was spread all around the world. He was the most powerful English Freemason during the first half of the century. So this was the situation in Europe before the French Revolution. It's interesting to observe these three gestures of these three Western states: small, tight, unitary, disciplined. These huge empires in the East, rather more ramshackle, difficult to control, loose, hard for their capitals to keep tabs on them. Freemasonry strong in England, France, Scandinavia. Jesuitism strong in these places. The Jesuit order had actually been suppressed by the Pope himself in 1773. And the Jesuits had sort of escaped to, particularly to Prussia and to Russia, whose autocratic rulers saw them as good teachers for their children, for the educators of the elites in their countries. So a kind of spiritual struggle behind the scenes, nevertheless, was going on between the Masons and the Jesuits. And interestingly, as the Masons were suppressed by the Pope himself in 1773, the Masons split in the 1750s. So the Masonic order was divided in two. The Irish Freemasons played a big role in that, some of you may know. And so you had a split kind of between the, which was started by the Irish Freemasons and the English Freemasons. And that split basically split the whole Freemasonic world for about 60 years. And then in the around the 1813 period, not least due to this man and his brother, the Duke of Kent, father of Queen Victoria, two leading Freemasons, they managed to reunite the Freemasonic order in 1813. And the following year, the Pope re-established the Jesuit order. This is a very interesting fact, that during the same period, both Masons and Jesuits were kind of suffered a certain, you could say, a weakening in their powers. And then, not long after the birth of Kasper Hauser, they were both, in a certain sense, gained power again and were sort of reconstituted. So here's the picture that is often described of Kasper as he is supposed to have appeared. It's only an imagination, as I say, on 26th of May 1828. And then he's put with this jailer, Hiltzel. And Hiltzel was a man who really knew human nature. He was a man of the heart. He was not educated, but he had seen some of the worst as a jailer that humanity could produce. And yet, both he and the liar was no deceiver. So he's a man of the heart, looking into a man who could weigh up the worst of human nature, and looked into Kasper's soul and said, this is a pure being. And he was not the only one. Then Kasper was seen by the opposite. He was seen by two representatives of the modern science, doctors, Dr. Proy, Dr. Osterhausen, and they tested him and looked at him physically, and they noticed especially his bone structure of his knees. And they realized that Kasper's bones were, and his leg formation was such that this was a young man who had clearly been forced to sit on the ground with his legs out in front of him like this, you see. Yeah? Because you couldn't put anything behind his knees here. Yeah? And they saw that his bone structure was very different from other people. They noticed also the nature of his feet and the way in which he would always sit bolt upright. And their report, from a natural scientific perspective, was that this young man must have been kept in prison-like conditions and must have been deprived of freedom of movement for a long time. So those are the first who saw Kasper, so to speak. And then we have Mayor Bindu, I've referred to, who, as I say, something in Kasper touched him, and he announced Kasper to the world as the child of Europe. And then arranged through the offices of the judge Feuerbach, I'll show you in a minute, to be given over to Georg Friedrich Daumer as his first teacher and guardian, a man whom Rudolf Steiner described as the last Rosicrucian, meaning that Daumer was a man who both was a deeply spiritual man, but also had a modern scientific consciousness. And he was able to bring these two things together. And somebody who truly cared about Kasper, sought to heal him, sought to help him to become a modern person. That cut both ways, because Kasper, through this well-meaning education that Daumer gave him, Kasper lost a number of the capacities which he had. So that he was able, for example, to see in the dark. You might think that's not surprising, since he'd been kept in the dark for many years. But he could see in the dark, he could see and feel, rather, people approaching from over 50 to 100 meters away, who were, he could feel those people approaching without seeing them. He could, when people touched him, depending on the quality of those people, he had very strange sensations of temperature, shuddering. When insects such as spiders landed on him, the same thing. With snakes, the same thing. He could calm animals. All of this, of course, is written about by Daumer and other people. Yeah? It's all documented. He could calm animals that other people could not calm. He soon became a very capable rider of horses. In fact, horses had a deep meaning for him throughout the 5 years of his life in the public. He had strange reactions to colour. He hated the colour green and loved the colour red. He wanted the whole world to be painted red. And was shown the world, when the windows were open and he was shown the world, he turned away from it and said, nasty, nasty, can't stand it, no, no. And when later Feuerbach, the judge, after a couple of years, reminded him of that and said, why was that that you had that reaction to the world? Yeah? Kasper, who by now was able to think, said, it was because I couldn't make any sense of it. It was just a chaos. It was just shapes and colors which I couldn't make any sense of at all. And that's why I rejected it. I had to turn away from it. That's very interesting, because it points to the fact that his consciousness was, in a sense, the consciousness of a small baby, you see, an infant, who has, as it were, perception, but is not able to make any sense because he's not able to bring any concepts to what he's observing. Yeah? And that was what, of course, Daumer and others then helped him to do. But of course, in doing that, that means that he loses the pure perceptions of an infant. He loses, in a certain sense, the real purity of soul that every infant has. And he learns then to conceptualize, to name, and of course, that means to label. He grows up, which we all do, yeah? And that has, obviously, good sides and bad, so to speak. This is Dharma later in life. He was taught by the philosopher Hegel at school, deeply influenced by him, by Schelling, and by Jakob Böhme, the mystic of the 17th century, and by German pietists. So he had a really excellent upbringing. And he was also a homeopath, when homeopathy had only recently been developed. This is Kasper's champion and truth seeker, Anselm von Feuerbach. He's the man who realized, as one of Germany's leading criminologists, that a serious crime had been done against this child and was determined to get to the root of it. And he did. It took him a few years, but in 1832, he published his findings. He had realized that Kasper was the Prince of Baden and that he had been abducted and that this was the crime against him and he'd been falsely imprisoned. He sought to publish these findings and gave these findings sort of semi-secretly, in a sense, to various people high in the elite. A possible consequence of this was that he died prematurely in May 1833, so 6 months before Kasper Hauser, and he himself believed that he'd been poisoned. There were quite a few people who were keen to get him out of the way. And he was Kasper's last champion in the town of Ansbach. This is Kasper's second guardian, Baron von Tucher. He was married to the, Tucher's sister. His sister was married to the philosopher Hegel. So another connection with the philosopher Hegel, one of Germany's greatest idealists. And Hegel was teaching in Nuremberg in 1808 to 1816, where he produced some of his most famous works. So that's Kasper, aged 18, in September 1831. The painting, which was actually paid for by the English agent Lord Stanhope, who turns up in May of 1831. The fourth Earl of Stanhope, 1781 to 1855, direct descendant of King Henry VIII, sorry, Henry III, going back to the 13th century. He described himself as an old Tory of Mr. Pitt's school, a secret agent, an occult researcher. Well, he didn't call himself an occult researcher. It's been taken quite a long time to find out that he was one. He called himself an old Tory of Mr. Pitt's school. But he was indeed an occult researcher, and I'll go into that later on after the break, yeah? Which we are now coming to. Stanhope removed Kasper from his circle of protectors in Nuremberg and placed him in the home of this tyrannical, oppressive man, the teacher, Johann Meyer, who basically drilled Kasper with Latin and mental torture. So having been physically tortured, he was tortured through education now. In Ansbach, this is his wife, and these were paid by Stanhope. And then even decades later, this man's son, Julius, wrote a book against Kasper Hauser, which Dahmer himself then countered. So this man was one of the torturers, you might say, of Kasper's last 2 years of life. And when Kasper was fatally wounded in 1833, his life forces were so powerful, he was stabbed just at the very bottom of the heart. And his life forces were so powerful that he somehow managed to pick himself up, stagger back to his house, and tell Meyer what had happened. Meyer refused to believe him because Meyer was constantly telling Kasper, you are a fraud, you're a swindler, I don't believe you. And he'd been doing that for 2 years because he was paid by Stanhope. Then he insisted that Kasper take him back to the park where he'd been stabbed, which he did. He forced him to take him back to the park. There they found the purse which the murderer had given to Kasper. And then they went all the way back again This is December, so in winter. And then Kasper finally collapsed and died 3 days later from this wound. All the time, Meyer insisting he stabbed himself. Well, those who knew Kasper would tell you, and this is well documented, this is a young man who could not harm a fly, who protested vociferously even if a flea was killed, let alone if a human being was whipped or beaten. The idea that he could commit any kind of bloody violence against himself or anybody else is a complete nonsense. This is the murder weapon which is later found in the park with the skull and crossbones design and an hourglass here. Motifs very common to Freemasonic lodges of that period. We now know who the murderer was and who organized the crime, as I said, which took place here, as I showed you earlier. So, to sum up then, this individuality, Kasper Hauser, was caught up in five cases of evil. He was caught up, first of all, in the personal ambitions of two women. The Countess of Hochberg, who wanted her own, the line of her own children to be the Dukes of Baden. So she was the one who abducted the baby. And she involved this man, Major Hennenhofer, in helping her to abduct the baby. And then later, the second Lady Macbeth, so to speak, involved in the story was the Grand Duchess Sophie, who was married to her son, who became the Grand Duke of Baden as a result of the abduction. This Duke, Grand Duchess Sophie, was then determined that she would not lose her position. So she was the one who then gets Major Hennenhofer to arrange the murder in 1833. So purely personal desires, human, all too human desires of two women. Then Kasper was caught up in the territorial ambitions of two men, two Ludwigs, Ludwigs of Bavaria and Ludwig of Baden, and they were fighting over the things that men often fight over, territory, political territory. But there was a special reason for that, I'll tell you after the break. That led to Kasper's imprisonment, long-term imprisonment, in this darkened state in Bavaria, in the prison which was owned by one of his subordinates. And then he was caught up in the personal malevolence of two servants of events, you might say. This is what Lord Stanhope called himself. I was a servant of events. Major Hennenhofer, who worked for the Countess of Hochberg and the Grand Duke Duchess Sophie, so he worked for Baden. And Lord Stanhope, who was a British secret agent who was seconded to Vienna. So this personal malevolence of this personal evil, you might say, of these two men leads to the abduction, in this case, Hennenhofer, and then the seduction, which Stanhope brought about, by drawing Kasper to himself. So he was so successful in this seduction, he managed to get inside the soul of this young boy to such an extent that Kasper himself asked the city authorities in Nuremberg to be handed over to Lord Stanhope to be his guardian. That's how successful, how skillful Stanhope was. And then there was the assault, again organized by Hennenhofer and Court of Baden, and finally the murder, organized from the same direction. And then, as I've already mentioned, the 2-year slander campaign by Stanhope after Kasper's death. Behind all this, behind this petty struggle for territory of these two princes, were the designs, the major geopolitical designs of Britain and Austria, conservative powers that were determined that nobody related in any way to Napoleon would sit on any European throne. So when they realized that Kasper was out there somewhere, they realized here is a person we haven't known about till now. We have to find him, we have to nullify him. So they then commissioned Stanhope, this British secret agent, to go looking for this boy. Stanhope couldn't find him for many years. Why not? Because he was in prison. But as soon as Kasper was then released by the Bavarians into the public, and I'll explain why that was later on, then Stanhope immediately sees, there he is. So he immediately goes to Nuremberg and begins his campaign of seduction, giving him money, giving him presents, drawing him into his orbit. So that was his task, isolating him, taking him to Ansbach. And then behind this political macro struggle between the British and the Austrians lies the enmity between two spiritual principles of Freemasonry anchored in Britain and Jesuitism anchored for a long, long time in the Austrian Empire, in the Habsburg Empire in Vienna. So these are the various cases of situations of evil that Kasper was caught up in. And these different things, attacks on the physical life, attacks on the life forces of a human being, attacks on the soul forces of a human being in a seduction, attack even on the personal identity, the ego of a human being in the slander and the discrediting, which is still going on today, 180 years later. All of this individual is caught up in, and I think today it has to do with what the center of Europe can mean for Europe today. And I'll talk a bit about that after the break. So thanks very much. Perhaps just summarize. So, one thing I should mention, where is he? Gentleman, I think he's maybe, he's just gone out.
Barry.
Yeah, anyway, he mentioned there was something I'd sort of passed over without mentioning. I should mention that. And that was, I refer to an assault, yeah, that had taken place against Kasper Hauser. In 1829 was the first physical attack on him. So this is about a year and a half after he first appeared. There was an attack on him in the house of the teacher Dalmer. And somebody came at him with a meat cleaver, and he managed to survive, but with a serious wound in his forehead. The attempted killer then ran off. One of the consequences of that was that whereas Dalmer's efforts to sort of educate Kasper had resulted slowly in him losing some of these capacities, these special abilities I mentioned, after this attack, they started coming back again, which is rather strange. But at the same time, he also started becoming very fearful and very suspicious of other people, what was going on, and that's hardly surprising. Because remember, he didn't know who he was or anything about himself, and then suddenly somebody tries to kill him. But that was the first attack in October 1829, and that failed. So that then, the second attack was the actual fatal stabbing. So just to remind you then, in the House of Baden, this is the main line, Carl Friedrich, who is basically Kasper's great-grandfather. And he had two wives. And you see from this first wife, he had three sons. And Kasper's grandfather, well, he died in an accident in Spain. And then his son, Carl, who was Kasper's father, he was poisoned in 1818. And he's the one who marries Napoleon's adoptive daughter. And they had two children. There was baby Kasper, who was abducted, so he's sort of out of it. And then there was another baby, Alexander. He lived only for 1 year. And he was poisoned too in 1816. So this was done basically by this woman, Luisa Gaia von Geisberg. But this, again, is a wonderful name. Luisa Gaia means vulture. Luisa Vulture of Vulture Mountain. I mean, it's amazing, isn't it? You couldn't make it up.
I was writing this.
Yeah, exactly. But that was her name. And then, of course, when she later on, she changed her name when she rose even higher in status, so to speak, and adopted the name von Hochberg, which means high mountain. So anyway, the result of these men in this line, the males, all being taken out, then she was able to get her eldest son, Leopold, to be eventually, after the death of this one. And she basically bribed him, saying, well, you can be Grand Duke, but you're not to marry and you're not to have any children. And he accepted that deal because he had been her lover anyway. They knew each other pretty well, and they were both unscrupulous. So he enjoyed himself for 10 years as Grand Duke, had his own mistress, no children, officially. So then he basically hands it back to her, and then her eldest son can become the Grand Duke. And then as a result of this crime, we come down to this fascinating event here. That at the end of the First World War, this, by the way, is the present head of the family, Prince Max von Baden, one of Germany's most richest landowners today and wine growers. But his grandfather, also named Max, at the end of the First World War was the last chancellor of Imperial Germany. And he was the chancellor for only 2 months. And he was the one who was basically responsible for closing or winding down the Empire of Germany and sort of translating it, as it were, into a republic. But before he did that, he had two meetings with Rudolf Steiner. And Rudolf Steiner attempted to convince this man's grandfather, Max von Baden, to make peace with the Allies on the basis of what Steiner called the threefold society, the threefold social movement. And that was a vision of society based on the threefold structure of the human being. I won't go into that now because that would take a whole other lecture. But Max von Baden chose not to do that. And instead, he chose to make peace with the Allies on the basis of President Wilson's 14 points, which was disastrous. And Steiner, for example, described that as the spiritual capitulation of Germany, which went along with the military capitulation. It was disastrous, not only for Germany, but for the whole of Central Europe. And you could say that even in the 1990s, we were paying the price of it. But the point I want to make, just want to draw your attention to, is that all of this, and Steiner's conversation with precisely this individual, is the result of this crime, you see, of this ancestor, Louisa Vulture of Vulture Mountain, back here, Lady Macbeth number one. Yeah? And I don't see that lightly, because she really was. And so, in a sense, Steiner was giving this Max von Baden a chance to put right by what his ancestor had done by helping Germany to take a positive step at the end of this catastrophe of the World War. Unfortunately, he wasn't up to it. So his grandson today is the head of the family, born 1933. So there's Kasper and his father. I mean, you can decide for yourself whether there's any facial resemblance there. Many people think there is. And his mother, Stephanie of Baden. And that's Lady Macbeth and Boulogne, Louisa. Now she, and that's her later in life, not quite so ravishing. But the interesting thing is, you see, that the place where she put him was a piece of territory where, which was in a sense her private possession within the House of Baden at that time. And later, the key event which really helped Feuerbach to solve the crime was when Kasper, during those 5 years, began to remember some of the events of his very early childhood. And one of the things he remembered was this coat of arms, which is here in this castle. And that was one of the key pieces of evidence which helped Feuerbach to track down which aristocratic family was at the root of this problem. This is the place in Pilsach, south of Nuremberg, where he was kept from early 1817 to May 1828, which was owned—that's the entrance to it—which was owned by this man, Major Griesenbeck, who was the servant of Crown Prince later Ludwig of Bavaria, as I mentioned before. So here's Ludwig, and the interesting thing about him is it's not only Kasper in this story whose childhood suffers. Also the guys and one woman on the other side, so to speak, their childhood suffered too. That's an interesting motif in all this. Because the reason why he was having this sordid political battle, which is so important, which led to the imprisonment of Kasper, was that he himself had been brought up in a piece of territory in Baden, which Napoleon had taken from Bavaria and given to Baden. So he lost his childhood home, the place where he'd been brought up between the ages of 7 and 14. And he spent his entire life trying to get that back again from the Badeners, you see. And his plan was that because England and Austria would not allow him to make war against Baden and take it back by force, he had to find some other way. And so the way that they found was to use this boy, who they knew was in fact the Prince of Baden, and then turn him into an idiot. And then having done that by imprisoning him and making him not know who he was, and then releasing him at a crucial point in the whole story, putting him on the chessboard, so to speak, as a pawn, and communicating to Baden, well, if you don't give us what we want, then we will reveal to the world who this boy is. And then waiting to see if Baden would do that. Well, in the end, they didn't. Because Leopold actually, he revealed to the barbarians that he couldn't give a damn whether he couldn't stand the job after a year or two of doing it. And if he was out of a job, he didn't care. So they were banking on the fact that the shame and the humiliation would force him to hand this piece of territory over, you see. If he had to reveal that his mother had been involved in the abduction and so on. But it didn't work. The plan didn't work in the end. But all his life, he wanted to get back this piece of territory. And this leading Jesuit theologian was one of the two men who were his key educators. The key educators of the Crown Prince, later King Ludwig of Bavaria. Now, some anthroposophists, that means pupils of Rudolf Steiner, have speculated, and I must insist it's really only speculation, going on a certain indication from Steiner, but not something which is really, I would say, really solid, that it was the Jesuits who were behind this long-term incarceration of Kasper Hauser from 1817 to 1828, because only they knew that if we killed this boy, you see, the question was often, well, why didn't they just kill him? And if you just kill him, then you've got no problem, right? So why go to the extent of putting him in prison for all these years and turning him into this idiot like this, yeah? And then they theorized, well, it must have been because the Jesuits had occult knowledge that if you kill a remarkable individuality, he'll come back again straight away, reincarnate immediately, and will continue his task. So you have to prevent him from doing that. Yeah? So that's why they opted instead to imprison him and turn him into a fool who didn't know himself. That's a theory. But I have to emphasize that there is no real solid proof of that. All I've been able to find out so far is that it is the case that this leading Jesuit, this man Zambuga, is not a Jesuit, but he was a keen pupil of this Jesuit. And this was certainly the leading Jesuit in Germany in that time. Zeile went on to become Bishop of Regensburg and was promoted to that position by Ludwig of Bavaria. Ludwig, that's a fact. But to say then that they had this occult knowledge that, you see where I'm going, yeah? That they have this knowledge that if we imprison Kasper, then we'll be able to frustrate his mission. That for me is a step too far. We have to wait. We don't know that for certain yet. More knowledge, more research has to be done, I think, and the contemplation of the lives of, for example, these two men, and also of Ludwig. But we do have, I think, a much more plausible understanding in the struggle between these two over this political question, between this sordid political issue of Baden and Bavaria, the desire to create Kasper a fool, an idiot out of him, to then use him as a pawn to gain territory from the other side. So this is the piece of territory in question, the Palatinate, yeah. And these are the two men in question. Thanks very much, I didn't mention your point. No, not at all, cheers, thank you for coming. Yeah. So this is the Palatinate here with Heidelberg and Mannheim, the two big cities in that region. This is Major Hennenhofer, who was in charge of both of the abduction and of the murder gang, four-man murder team. He wasn't in it, he was in Karlsruhe at the time, but he sent the four men to do it. We know who they were now. And this was his master until 1830. So these are the characters who are involved in the crime against Kasper. The two women, the one who was responsible for the abduction, the one who was responsible for the murder, who gave the order for him to organize the murder gang. Sophie of Sweden, She was the Crown Princess of Sweden. She lost her childhood home at the age of 9 when her father, the King of Sweden, was ousted in a military coup. Her father was a very strange man, obsessed with the number 666. So much so that the Swedish military officers who ousted him in a kind of joke paid him 666,000 Swedish kronas as a goodbye present. And then he went into exile with his family. And where did they go? They went to Baden. And why? Because his wife was a princess of Baden. So his wife was also related by blood to Kasper Hauser, you see. Very interesting. So she lost her childhood home, and she was determined she would not lose her position a second time. Hence the order for the murder. Here's Metternich, the sort of spider of Vienna, who is behind the scenes of everything going on in Europe at that time, in the first half of the 19th century. Stanhope is seconded to Austria by the British government. These are the two Ludwigs I mentioned. I'm not going to say anything about him because you notice a lot of question marks. His name is Sigismund von Reitzenstein. He's commonly called the Bismarck of Baden, who helped to create the modern state of Baden. He's there because, and this is on my question, I please emphasize that. Please don't think that I'm saying this categorically because I don't know. But I think he's a candidate, at least, for solving one of the biggest questions which still remains in the mystery. And the mystery is, how did this child get from the one castle, Boygen, which I showed you, to the second castle near Nuremberg, where he was kept for 11 years or so? Because the first castle was in the territory of Baden, and the second castle is in the territory of Bavaria, and they're enemies. So how did that transfer happen? We don't know. There has to be more research into that. That's a part which has not been solved yet. But he's certainly a candidate because he's a very powerful man in Baden, but his origins are in Bavaria. He's originally from Bavaria and he knew everybody in the elite in Bavaria. Okay. So just a few things about Stanhope before we come to the last part about Europe today. That's Stanhope's father I mentioned, this strange, the Quixote of the nation, as he was known. Very hard-hearted man, scientific rationalist. A bit of a mystery in himself. And these are Stanhope's highly placed relatives, Pitt Prime Minister, Grenville, the Foreign Minister. All of these men had spies, employed spies themselves on the continent. But he was the greatest spy master of them all, Francis Jackson. Personal connections, because he studied in Germany as a young man, personal connections with Metternich's secretary, Gentz, hence the connection. And it was he who enabled Stanhope to escape from his father and go and study in Germany, in Erlangen, which is just up the road from Nuremberg, as it happens. So Stanhope was sent by Jackson, the spymaster, first of all, in his first job, to Sicily. Very interesting place. To spy and keep an eye on the client state, the client rulers of Sicily, which was a puppet state of England at the time. He spent a few years there, and in 1812, something very interesting happened to Stanhope. Now again, we don't really know exactly where this happened, but he was based in Palermo. And we know that he says that south of Palermo, so it could be anywhere in this sort of region, south of Palermo, he had the only epileptic fit which happened to him in his life. One time, it was deeply frightening and shocking to him. He went frozen cold, collapsed on the ground, shuddering and shaking, and it never happened again. And it's interesting to see, this was July the 9th, 1812, a couple of months before Kasper is born. It's interesting to see what's in this area. Here, for example, south of Palermo, we have the town of Corleone. Does that mean anything to anybody? The Mafia, right. It's the centre of the Mafia, right, later on. I don't know whether it was then, because I'm not an expert on the Mafia, but certainly that's what it was then. But even here, we have something even more interesting. Here's the town of Ribera. Ribera. Here, not far away, you have Calta Bellotta. Does that mean anything to anybody? Calta Bellotta. Klingsor. Right. Calta Bellotta means Castle of the Oaks. It's the place where in the 9th century Landulf of Capua, otherwise known as Klingsor in the Grail story, or also in Wagner's opera, who becomes a kind of a black magician, flees from mainland Italy to this place, which was controlled by the Saracens at the time, and stays with the Saracens, and this was his base for his operations. Klingsor described, regarded in esoteric circles, as one of the darkest figures in European history. Now again, as I say, we don't know exactly where Stanhope suffered this attack, but it's interesting, first of all, that it was in Sicily, and it was interesting that it's south of Palermo. It's not, for example, in the west, the east of Sicily. That is Caltabellotta. A couple of other views. But I must press on. I just want to notice one interesting thing here I'd like to draw your attention to. Here's Palermo, in the region south of Palermo. If you extend a line from Palermo through Rome, then you continue this line up through Germany, you arrive at Nuremberg, Nuremberg Ansbach region. If you then look at, you join the line from London to Vienna, the two major powers which are, as I say, behind the scenes of the Kasper story, you find that this line crosses this line in the same region, Nuremberg, Ansbach. And if you also draw a line from Karlsruhe, where Kasper is born, to Karlstein, I'll speak about that in a minute, you'll see that, which is just west of Prague, you'll see that this also passes through the same region. This is Karlstein. And it was built by that Charles IV I mentioned, the 14th century, who was so important for the history of Central Europe. It was built by him first to house the crown jewels of the Holy Roman Empire, which were later moved to Nuremberg. This is a remarkable place. Wonderful esoteric art is contained in this store, in this tower up here, and an absolutely incredible artistic jewel in the chapel of the this amazing sacred chapel up at the top there. This is the Karlsruhe Palace. I've spoken about them and all of that. Just pass on. I've spoken about these. Right, Stanhope. Just a few words about Stanhope before we come to the last part about Kasper and York today. Cheveling is his family home in Kent, in England. Now, in 1969, the Stanhope line died out after seven Earls Stanhope, they died out. And the last Earl decreed that the family home should be given either to the British government or to the royal family. Only they were to use it. Prince Charles did not want it, so it was given to the British government. And it was made into the official residences of the British foreign secretaries. So the official residence of the Prime Minister is Chequers, country residence, and the official country residence of the foreign minister is this, Stanhope's old former family seat. And the first foreign minister to avail himself of it was Lord Carrington, Margaret Thatcher's first foreign secretary. Who's he? General Secretary of NATO in the early 80s, and also Chairman of the Bilderberg Group, if that means anything to you. One of the leading Anglo-American transatlantic groups, secret groups, elite groups, which is acting behind the scenes since the 1950s to supervise the European Union project and to also keep the elites of America and Europe together. But we find that Carrington is a direct descendant of Stanhope's brother-in-law. He's Robert, 2nd Baron Carrington, who was one of his political allies in the 1840s and 50s. So those families are also connected. And then also the chief, we mentioned the Rhodes Scholar earlier on, right? Which brings over the American up-and-coming elite. The Cheveling is also not only used by the British foreign ministers, it's also used to bring over the elites from the third world countries to fill their heads full of all the things which they can benefit from connections to the English elite, you see. So the elites of the political classes of Africa, of Asia, of Latin America are brought over to Cheveling when they're rising up as young people and they are educated, as it were, and then they go back to their own countries and create networks of influence and so on. That's the other thing that goes on, the Chevening scholarships. You can check that out on their website. Stanhope was an ultra-Tory, arch-conservative. These are two of his main political allies, but another one of his main political allies was Benjamin Disraeli. His two uncles I've already mentioned. And his other political ally and friend of Disraeli, in fact the man who opened the political doors for Disraeli, created his entree into society, is the famous novelist Edward Bulwer Lytton, probably known to some of you, yeah? Who wrote the famous esoteric novel Zanoni. These three men were not only involved in the same political direction, they were also involved in occult research together. We'll come to that in a minute. But when Disraeli became Prime Minister, he made Bulwer Lytton's son, that's him, Robert, the first Viceroy of India. So here he is, relaxing. As the first Viceroy of India in 1876. Yeah? And he was the guy who took Britain into the second Afghan war. So he set up the second of Britain's Afghan wars. So the first Viceroy of India under Victoria, when she was made Empress of India by, again, none other than Disraeli. And it was then also Disraeli who was best man, so to speak, at the marriage of Hannah de Rothschild and Philip Archibald Primrose, 5th Earl Rosebery. Well, you may not know of him. He was a Liberal Prime Minister in the 1890s, but he was also the grandson of none other than Lord Stanhope. So he met Lord Stanhope when Stanhope was very old, when he was very young. He described Chevening as a paradise on earth. He loved it when he was a child. Eh? So he's talked about by Rudolf Steiner as a great rhetorician, somebody through whom forces behind him speak out certain imperial goals towards the British public. And his three faction leaders in British politics were Sir Edward Grey, Herbert Asquith, and Haldane, Minister of War. And it's these three men, who he was the Prime Minister, who led Britain into the First World War, especially Sir Edward Grey in 1914. They venerated Lord Rosebery because they were all liberals. They were the leaders of the liberal imperialist faction. And this new concept of empire is something which is very much connected with Disraeli and Bulwer Lytton. Now these three guys, Bulwer Lytton, Disraeli, Stanhope, used to meet at the Countess of Blessington's salon in the 1830s and 40s, where they would do occult research together. Other people who used to frequent this salon were Charles Dickens, for example, Lord John Russell, and their famous fashion leader, the Count d'Orsay. And they did their research, and here's the Countess Blessington, and the place where they met is today the site of the Albert Hall in London. So that was her home. Not the building itself, but the site. Yeah? And her home was later demolished and it was built, the Albert Hall was built there. And that was where they used to have their meetings. And this was one of the most famous astrologers, Richard Morrison, Zadkiel at the time. And then we have one of Britain's most famous spies, the real James Bond at the time, Richard Burton. One of the famous painters, John Varley. And the Earl of Crawford, sorry I haven't got a picture of him. And they engaged in occult research through using crystal balls and black slate mirrors. Now we know of all of this from the writings of this girl, or woman, who was one of these girls, Emma Harding Britton. And she describes what this group, who used to call themselves the Orphic Circle. Orphic, from Orpheus, O-R-P-H-I-C. The Orphic Circle, and that's the name she gave them anyway. And she describes what they did and the various things they got up to, but only, she described this, after they were all dead. That was an occult principle, she said, that she was not allowed to speak about them until they had died. And you can find this information, very interesting it is too, about Stanhope's esoteric and occult researches in the book The Theosophical Enlightenment by Jocelyn Godwin. G-O-D-W-I-N, The Theosophical Enlightenment by Jocelyn Godwin. Personally, I find him a rather ambiguous figure, but certainly what he says about Stanhope, you'll not find anything in more detail in English. And I've not found anything in German. In fact, in Germany, Stanhope's occult activities on after Kasper's death were almost entirely unknown. So it's only known in English. But Godwin's work, The Theosophical Enlightenment, has a lot about Stanhope's work. And from that we see that Stanhope was the most educated, the most knowledgeable person in esoteric circles in England for some 30 years, in the 1830s, 40s and 50s, right until his death in 1855. I haven't got time to translate this all to you, but these are two letters which he wrote in 1 year before his death about his occult researches on the continent, letters from Rome and Turin, where he's even looking for occult machinery and reporting to his friend Johann Philipp von Wessenberg, who was again a close collaborator of Metternich, about these occult researches. So, as I mentioned, these four attacks against Kasper Hauser: infant abduction, imprisonment, seduction, and second abduction by Stanhope, in the sense that he took him away from his supporters and protectors, placed him in isolation and in the home of this appalling teacher, Maya, who gave psychologically tormented him. Then the assault I mentioned just now, 1829, the murder, 1833, and then the campaign of slander and discrediting, which is still going on. And so we can see in all of this an example of how the dark forces in today's world too are still working, still using these same techniques. If you can't bribe somebody, or you can maybe imprison them, or you murder them, but at least you can, or you can take up, you can steal their identity. I mean, that's more, even technologically now, we can do that, right? Identity theft. We see Kasper, in a sense, being one of the early victims of all of these different methods used by the forces which are opposed to human progress. Now, you remember I said at the beginning, Rudolf Steiner pointed out that it's important to notice who is not there. And one of the important things about Kasper Hauser is that there were certain people who were not able to collaborate with him if he had become the rightful Prince of Baden. So he was born in 1812, and so at the time of the German Revolution in 1848, he would have been in his prime at the age of 36. In 1848, revolutions took place all over Europe, including Germany. And the German Revolution started in Baden and finished in Baden, where it was finally crushed by the Prussians, Prussian army. But it started and finished there because Baden was in fact the most liberal, the most progressive state in the German-speaking world. That's interesting also in itself. If Kasper, with his personal qualities, which are attested to so much by the people who knew him, had become the leader of that state, then at the Frankfurt Parliament in 1848, which was called by all the finest representatives of German political and cultural life to try to unify the country and give it a new constitution, they were looking for a person who could become the figurehead of this new Germany. And he was not there, Kasper, as Prince of Baden, because he'd been killed in 1833. But there were people who, if he had been there, could have collaborated with him. For example, there was this man, Ferdinand Lassalle, who was the Jewish leader of the German Social Democrat Workers' Movement, the first really mass Social Democrat movement in Germany. A man of the heart, a man of feeling, a man who knew how to appeal to ordinary people. What happened to him? Well, in 1864, because he was such a man of the heart, he was killed in a duel over a woman. So, he was out. And then we have Ludwig II. Well, he's the man who built the famous castles.
So this is, remember, it was Ludwig I I mentioned before, the previous Ludwig, who was his grandfather, not this one. This is the builder of the castles, whom even Disney World is, unfortunately, you know, based on the castle, the amazing castle, this one, Neuschwanstein. He built this. Yeah? New Swan Stone, Neuschwanstein. I've been there, the whole thing is based on Wagner's operas. And they take you around it at a pell-mell pace, you know, you only get half an hour to see the whole thing inside. It's terrible. But the big great hall is entirely devoted to Parsifal. So clearly Ludwig II was looking somehow to, and he was a deeply idealistic man, so idealistic his feet weren't really on the ground, you could say, that he was looking to found a kind of grail center in Bavaria at that time. And certainly Rudolf Steiner indicated that this was a possibility, that a new grail culture could have been created in the 19th century at this time. His idea was the Swan Knight, Ludwig's, Lohengrin. And it was when he saw particularly this opera by Wagner, Lohengrin, that moved him. And then when he became the king of Bavaria, the first thing he did was he called for Wagner and said, "You've got no more problems from now on." So without him, we wouldn't have, in all probability, Bayreuth and Wagner's operas. He contributed greatly to the publicizing, as it were, the success of Wagner's operatic oeuvre. Kasper Hauser, 6 months before he died, was confirmed. The last person who really helped him after the murder of the judge, Feuerbach, was pastor of the church, Pastor Fuhrmann. And it was Pastor Fuhrmann who confirmed him, helped him to understand Christianity, and confirmed him in the church of St. Gumbertus in Ansbach in May of 1833, 6 months before his murder. And he was confirmed in the chapel of the Swan Knights in St. Gumbertus Church. So we see another strange and interesting connection then with Ludwig II. So in other words, if these men, and even Otto von Bismarck, you see, you might ask, well, why is Bismarck there? Isn't he the man of blood and iron? Well, yes, he's the man of willpower. But interestingly, in the last year of this man's life, these two had a secret political conversation. Secret political correspondence. They wrote many letters to each other. And it's clear they had a real insight into each other's character, even a kind of political sympathy. And indeed, it's from him that Bismarck learned all about the welfare system, which he then sets up in the Imperial Reich later on. But Bismarck also had correspondence with him. I mean, you can't get any more different than these two guys. But again, there was some strange kind of understanding between these two men. And the point is that if Kaspar Hauser had been there within the circle of these men, then the history of Germany in the second half of the 18th century may have been very different. And Kaspar Hauser would also have been able to cooperate with this individual, Prince Albert, here in Britain. I beg your pardon. There in Britain. There in Britain. Prince Albert, of course, married to Queen Victoria. And he's a very interesting man, Prince Albert, if you look into what he did. Yeah? He did a tremendous amount in Britain. He had an incredible range of interests. And he died prematurely, 1861. But if Kaspar Hauser had been there with these other men in Germany and had been able to collaborate with Prince Albert, who also had his own vision of a new constitutional form for Germany, not a sort of centralized power state as it later became, things may well have been very different. And things may not have ended up in the poisonous relationship which later developed between King Edward VII, the son of Victoria, and the Kaiser Wilhelm II, who these two hated each other with real venom. And their poisonous relationship was one of the things which led to was one of the things that led to World War I, you could say. One of the things. Disraeli, who was a very dodgy character in some ways, but was certainly a judge of character, said, "With Prince Albert, we have buried our sovereign. This German prince is governing for 21 years with a wisdom and an energy such as none of our kings has ever shown." It's interesting. If you don't know the career of Prince Albert, have a look. He really is quite a remarkable character. So here is Max von Baden, as I mentioned, the last Chancellor of Imperial Germany. And it was on this date, look at these dates here. On the 3rd of October, he becomes the last Chancellor of Germany. 3rd of October, does that ring a bell? October was German Reunification Day, 1990. Okay? And then he ended the empire and turned it into the Republic. First day of the Republic, 9/11, 1918, the 9th of November, a different 9/11, 9th of November. Yeah? And if you look at that date, again, very interesting. The 9th of November was also 1923, was also the date of Hitler's attempted putsch in Munich. 9th of November 1938, Kristallnacht, where the synagogues were destroyed. 9th of November 1989, Berlin Wall went down. So mysteriously, this date seems to resonate through the history of Germany. And remember, this is the man who was doing this as a result of the crime committed against Kasper Hauser by his ancestor. He is said to have said that when he was made formally the head of the House of Baden, which never actually happened in the end, that he would transfer Kasper's remains from Ansbach to the family tomb in Pforzheim. He never did that. But that suggests that he was also actually persuaded of the truth of Kasper. And here is his grandson, as I said, direct descendant of the Council of Hochberg, one of Germany's largest landowners. Here he is with, a bit younger, with King of Romania. Here's his eldest son, Prince Bernhard, the head of the family businesses today. The family runs one of Germany's elite boarding schools, Saarland, which is where the Duke of Edinburgh was educated during the Nazi regime. From 1932 to 1936, So for 3 years under the Nazis, the Duke of Edinburgh was educated here. It became an SS center during the war. The SS took it over. But that's an interesting point, because this was founded by his grandfather with Herbert Hahn. Yeah? Kurt Hahn, I beg your pardon. Kurt Hahn, who was Jewish, and then fled, having founded this school together with his grandfather, fled to Scotland, where he set up Kurt Hahn Gordonstone, where of course he was then again educated, and Prince Charles was also educated. Strange connections here. Yeah? But they are related, by family. And the von Baden family is still headed by him today. So, as I said, Daumer refuted Julius Meyer's attacks on Kasper Hauser right to the end of his life, and maintained that attacks on Kasper Hauser amounted to attacks on the best element in the German people and culture. And here we come, I think, to a certain nub of the question. In what kind of Europe do we really want? Do we want the superstate, which the economist wants, which the financiers in the Anglo-American world want, which Angela Merkel also seems to want, which the transatlanticists within the German elite also seem to want, which Barroso wants, which the Catholic Church evidently also wants? Do we want that kind of superstate, or do we want a different picture of Europe altogether? And could this different picture of Europe have come about if the crime of the 19th century had not happened? If the history of Germany had been different in the second half of the 19th century, what effect would have that had on the history of the 20th century? It's pretty obvious that what happened with Germany in the 20th century. But to make a crude example, when you catch a cold, you catch it from two directions. You catch it from a virus which comes from the outside, but you yourself do something to yourself to weaken your own immune system. And because you weaken your own immune system, the virus more easily attacks you from the outside. And I think this is what happened with Germany, that Germany went off the rails after 1848, which led eventually to the formation of the Reich in 1871, which was described by both Steiner and Nietzsche as a total disaster for German-speaking culture. Yeah? The extirpation of the German spirit is how Nietzsche described it. It was a disaster because it created this strong central Reich dominated essentially by Prussia and the Bismarck military element. So that could have been very different. But we also have to look at how other elements from outside, from London, from Vienna, played a part in this, forcing German history off the rails, so to speak, in the 19th century. So it happened something from two sides, from inside and from outside. And Rudolf Steiner pointed out in 1919, after the end of the First World War, after the signing of the Treaty of Versailles, that the Anglo-American element may well achieve world domination, but without the threefolding of society, without this new vision of a society organized on the basis of the human organism, the nervous system, the rhythmic system, the metabolic system, in relation to politics, cultural life, economic life, and without interference between these three spheres. But without this, this Anglo-American dominion will flood the world with the death of culture and the sickness of culture. And personally, I don't think it's too hard to see that that's exactly what has happened since the First World War. This is what we're facing today, not only in the ecological problems we face, which are based on the Anglo-American system of economics, capitalism, but also the geopolitical events, and of course, right at the moment with the financial crisis, which is not, I would submit, a crisis basically organized in Germany. It's a crisis which has its deeper roots precisely in the English-speaking world. So here we have two opposite pictures coming from the English-speaking world. One from Jeremy Bentham, philosopher of the 18th century, who said, "It's vain to talk of the interest of the community without understanding what is the interest of the individual." So he emphasizes the individual. This is what Anglo-American capitalism is preeminently based on, the self-centered interests of the individual. Ruth Benedict, the anthropologist, 20th century anthropologist, comes and says, "The life history of the individual is first and foremost an accommodation to the patterns and standards traditionally handed down in his community." So emphasizing the community's control or conditioning of the individual. This is really what the left wing politically would emphasize today. This is what the right wing would emphasize, yeah? And then Rudolf Steiner came along in 1905 and said, "A healthy social life is found only when in the mirror of each soul, the whole community finds its reflection. And when in the whole community, the virtue of each one is living." In other words, when in each individual, each individual is conscious of the whole of the community in everything he or she does, and when in the community respects the individual qualities of each person. Well, we don't have that really today, do we? And we need to struggle for an economic system which is based on this picture of society and the economy. This is what Steiner was hoping would come through with the threefold picture which he tried to put forward to Max von Baden at the end of the First World War. So it's this question, you see, can something of this kind still come forward from Central Europe? Or is Central Europe only to be regarded as a machine, an engine, a source of money and football and good motor cars? And that's what is emphasized from the West. But Dalma, in affirming the spiritual reality of Kasper Hauser, said no. As long as the German people, the people of Central Europe,
remain faithful to Kasper Hauser and stand up for him, then they will stand up for the best elements within their own people. And I think it's up to every people, in fact, to find that element within themselves, in every country, to find these characters, these individualities who stand for the best within the culture of each one of us. So I'll finish there, and thanks very much for your attention. Time you got left for questions, probably not very much, but if there are any.
What was Douglas Hurd doing in the presentation?
Say again?
Douglas Hurd.
Ah, what was Douglas Hurd doing in the presentation?
Achieving.
Achieving, oh, that's looking back quite a long way. It's because basically Douglas Hurd, I mean, he was one of the other foreign secretaries who used achieving. And, well, it's just interesting, after he retired, he went into writing novels, political novels, yeah? So what the interesting title of his novel was Vote to Kill. I mean, you just look at the British political system, you know, it's all about fighting two swords lengths opposite each other. That's how they sit in the House of Commons, yeah? You sit two swords lengths away from your opponent. It's all about attacking and slashing and slandering and battling and who can cut the finest. This is the essence of the British political system. You see, even more than the American political system. This is what the English political system has always been about. This cut and thrust, as it's called.
Doesn't it been described as the warrior nation?
The English? Well, yeah, I mean, you know, you've only got to go back to, well, when? I mean, arguably even 1066, yes. I mean, the Irish will know that it was within, what, 1066? When did the first Norman nobles land here? 1170, something like that? So it's 100 years, three generations, yeah? Pretty quick. Once they'd established, the Normans had established themselves in Britain, in England, over they were in Ireland, yeah? So, yes, I think one could certainly make that argument.
Terry, I think we've been up to the fact that Kasper Hauser had lived and it's possible to have a threefold social society come into being.
Yeah.
But Bruno Stein also said that if Kasper Hauser had lived and died as he did,
yeah,
that the human kind would have cut off in the spiritual war. So,
right.
How do you?
Right, and then if you heard that, the point here is made that Steiner also pointed out something which is actually, I feel, deeply esoteric. Mm. And really, I couldn't hope to do justice to it in answering your question. And this is why I felt in one short presentation tonight, I couldn't really go into that. But the point has just been made is that Steiner also indicated that if Kasper Hauser had not lived and died as he did, then contact with the spiritual world would have been cut off at that time. And that's a huge statement to make. What would have happened if this one individual had not lived and died as he did, then contact between the earthly and spiritual world would have been cut off? I mean, I think in a sense that's a statement which each one of us needs to really contemplate and think what that might have meant. But he's clearly pointing to an act of supreme sacrifice. Yeah? And we can also ask, is that a sacrifice only of an individual? Or is it also in a certain sense a sacrifice of a community? Many people have pointed to the similarity between the Christ-like nature, what happened to Kasper Hauser, and Christ himself, yeah? Which is basically the evil acts, the killing, ultimately, of the pure soul, the innocent. Yeah? In the case of Christ, a divine being. In the case of Kasper Hauser, what seems to be a human being. But certainly similarities there. And you can ask, well, what does that mean? What does that sacrifice mean? And what about the community within that sacrifice, within which that sacrifice takes place? So the Jewish community, the German community, yeah? What is this mystery between the Germans and the Jews, which comes to this incredible climax
in the 20th century. And in a sense, Nuremberg is, again, you know, 1934, 1946, is in a sense at the center of that. I don't feel like I always want to say too much about it at this point, because this is really a very deep-rooted question. But I really feel it has to do with the state, the spiritual state of Europe in the 19th century, which is deeply, deeply entering into materialism. And Steiner pointed out that when a being like Kasper Hauser comes into a situation like that, it's like a light in the darkness, and it challenges the materialism of that age to wake up to another way of human being. Yeah? When somebody like that appears within that darkness, and you can see how people responded to it. Some of them were responding wonderfully well, and others responded as only such a profoundly materialistic age could respond. But he did say that when somebody like that appears, it is a profound challenge. But the quote that you're citing is going even deeper. And I think I'd sort of like to leave it at that. Just those of you not aware of that, perhaps just something to think about.
Just very quickly, I know you mentioned already, Terry, but as to why Kasper Hauser wasn't, you know, murdered immediately because it favoured Ludwig I of Bavaria. But why did Georg von Gaisberg, the Lady Macbeth, as you call her, like, what was her connection to him? I don't see how she would have, like, because he ending up in Bavaria, that happened later, did it not?
Yeah, well, as I said, that's the mystery, Barry.
Okay.
We don't know how that happened. Yeah. That's one of the key elements in the story that's missing.
Right.
All this research that's been done, we know who the murders were, we followed the money trail, we know how Steiner was found, all this.
Yeah.
But how on earth, she somehow lost control of him, do you see?
Yeah.
She abducted the boy and then sort of dumped him in Boygan. The question then arises, well, why put him there then? Yeah. Why not kill him immediately? Well, the question is, of course, then again, Napoleon was still in power in 1812. Okay. When the baby was abducted, Napoleon was at the peak of his power. If Napoleon, who was the child's adoptive grandfather, had figured out that this, that, for example, the baby had been killed, then you know, that would be a pretty big gamble on her part. Yeah? I mean, she certainly wouldn't have survived his revenge, you see. It was bad enough that she abducted him. Right, but if she killed him, then she certainly would have survived. That's a possible thing that you have to bear in mind. Yeah? But why on earth she lost control of him from the castle in Boygan, which belonged to her, and then he ends up in the castle of the enemy state, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
That's a real conundrum, and we don't know that yet. That's a subject for further research. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, it does. Thanks.
Was Steiner aware of this guy's death? This kind of occult behind the European experiment.
That's a very good question. I haven't actually found any evidence yet that he was personally.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not to say, you know, in German somewhere there isn't something. Obviously, there are loads of things I haven't read. But in German somewhere there might be that Steiner was indeed aware of him. For example, Steiner was certainly aware of the sinking of the Titanic. Well, Stead was one of the most famous people who died on the Titanic.
Yeah.
Despite his much vaunted ability to communicate with the other world, he went down with the Titanic on his way to America. So perhaps Steiner read that, I don't know, but I haven't found that he was aware of it.
Sorry, Barbara, just tell us
to... Time.
Yeah, time.
Okay. So thank you again. Thanks very much for coming. Please. This is probably the best book on Kasper Hauser in English, by Peter Chodowski. Yeah. It's recently been republished. And it's a deeply moving and informative book. So I would thoroughly recommend that. Yeah. And there's also my own little book on him. But I would just also emphasize that my own little book on Kasper Hauser, if you ever bought this,
no money from this book goes to me. This book was gifted to Camp Hill, the Camp Hill organization in Britain and Ireland. So all profits from this book go to Camp Hill. Okay? So, but certainly the Trugovsky book is superb, I think. So if you're interested, have a look at that.